Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, professor of theoretical physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And this is Exploration. Every week in Exploration, we discuss the fascinating world of science and its impact on society. And today, leading off, we're going to summarize some of the top stories in science of the past week. Our lead story today concerns the war between billionaires. That is, Elon Musk, founder of SpaceX and Tesla Motors, is going head-to-head with Mark Zuckerberg, the billionaire behind Facebook. And it all concerns artificial intelligence. Mark Zuckerberg fired the first shot by saying that the dangers presented about artificial intelligence by Elon Musk were basically overblown, that artificial intelligence is great. And then Elon Musk fires back and says, wait a minute. Mark Zuckerberg simply does not understand. He has limited knowledge of the real dangers of artificial intelligence. So the first question is, who's right and who's wrong? And then a minor breakthrough has taken place concerning one day building a starship. That's right, we're not talking about going to Mars or Pluto. We're talking about going to the stars. There's a program called Breakthrough Starshot, pushed by Stephen Hawking and other distinguished scientists and billionaires, to send a chip to the nearest star. Well, they had a breakthrough just a few days ago. They successfully launched a chip 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters into orbit. It is the smallest satellite ever placed deliberately into orbit. And so then the next question is, when might we take the next leap to the stars? And then, speaking about stars and heaven, many people swear by near-death experiences. Many people claim that they see a light at the end of the tunnel. They have out-of-body experiences as they enter this near-death phase, and they have a feeling of calm and tranquility. Well, scientists have tried to understand this effect, and there's a new study analyzing scores of these individuals to try to see whether there's any systematic understanding of these symptoms. And of course, scientists themselves have tried to understand what is behind these near-death experiences. And then on the front page of the New York Times, once again, a new story concerns a new cancer therapy besides surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation. It turns out that gene therapy may open up a promising new way to attack cancers, which are currently incurable. Well, let's just jump right into some of the top stories in science. Our lead story today concerns the battle of the billionaires, a battle between the titans of technology. On one hand, we have Elon Musk, founder of SpaceX, PayPal, as well as Tesla Motors, a billionaire who created these industries out of nothing. And then on the other hand, we have yet another billionaire, Mark Zuckerberg, the force behind Facebook. And it turns out that a good fraction of the population of the entire planet is hooked on Facebook. And the battle between these tech titans erupted just a few days ago when Mark Zuckerberg poo-pooed the statements of Elon Musk. Elon Musk, for the past several years, has been warning people about the potential dangers of artificial intelligence. It's a potential existential risk, an existential danger that Homo sapiens faces, because one day, who knows when, one day the robots may take over. And we have to start educational programs. We have to start initiatives today to address the problem of super intelligent robots that may one day view us as rather ancient byproducts of an earlier age. That is, evolution may simply bypass Homo sapiens, and we may wind up in the dustbin of evolutionary history. Elon Musk conjures up a vision. Maybe one day the robots will put us in cages and make us dance behind bars and throw peanuts at us. Well, is that our future? Bah, humbug, says Mark Zuckerberg. No, he says, artificial intelligence promises us prosperity, labor-saving devices, new ways to make money, new ways to enrich society, he says. And so the question is, well, who's right? They can't both be right, right? Well, the answer is they are both right in a certain sense. Now, when you talk about love and war, you have to realize the key to understanding love and war is timing. Timing is everything in love. Timing is everything in war. And the same thing when it comes to artificial intelligence. For example, think of the invention of the airplane or the bow and arrow. When the bow and arrow was first invented, it was useful for hunting small game like squirrels and rabbits, but not much more given the clumsiness of our early bows and arrows. Eventually, however, bows and arrows matured to the point where you could hunt not just mastodons, you could also hunt fellow humans. And so we had a technology that came out of its infancy as being basically harmless and beneficial to a technology which became a double-edged sword. Think of the airplane. When the airplane was first invented by the Wright brothers, it was used basically for the transportation of mail and a few passengers, but not much more. Then, of course, came World War I, World War II, and then this device, the airplane, became an instrument of mass destruction, as well as the way in which to send passengers across the continents. So, in other words, technology is almost rarely just good or bad. Technology has a double-faced nature to it, just like a sword. A sword has a double-edged sword. One side of the sword can cut against ignorance, poverty, disease, but the other side of the sword can cut against people if it's used incorrectly. Now, take a look at the debate between Elon Musk and Mark Zuckerberg. In the short term, I think Mark Zuckerberg is right, and that is one day the artificial intelligence industry could become bigger than the automobile industry. There could be literally thousands of people employed as repairers of this technology, monitoring it, fixing it, designing new waves of artificially intelligent machines. And these are potentially labor-saving devices. Initially, robots will be used for dirty, dull, and dangerous jobs, the three Ds. Dirty, because they'll be used to clean up sewer systems and garbage. And dull, because they'll be doing repetitive work, work that is mind-numbing, but that's what robots are good for, because robots are, in fact, adding machines, very sophisticated adding machines. And robots will also do dangerous jobs as well. We already send them into outer space, where they face the possibility of radiation, micrometeorites, and of course, accidents. And we use robots to defuse bombs. And so dirty, dull, and dangerous jobs will be the ones used for robots at first. So I think on a scale of 20, 30 years, Mark Zuckerberg is basically right. But does that mean that we shouldn't think about the unthinkable? No. I think in the long term, Elon Musk is correct that yes, on a scale of decades, robots could one day pose a mortal threat to Homo sapiens. For example, our most advanced robot today is called Asimo. Asimo is a Japanese robot the size of a young boy. Asimo can run, jump, climb up stairs, and dance. In fact, Asimo even dances better than me. We've been on TV programs together. But I once interviewed for BBC television the inventor of Asimo, and he was rather blunt. He said on film that, yes, Asimo has the intelligence of an insect, a bug. Even a bug can scurry around the forest, evade predators, find mates, find food sources. Our most advanced robots can't do any of the above. You take one of our most advanced robots, put them in the middle of Fifth Avenue, and what do? They get lost. So, in other words, in the short term, I think that Mark Zuckerberg is correct. But in the long term, hey, let's be real about this. In the long term, robots will progress in intelligence. Right now, they have the intelligence of a cockroach. Eventually, they'll be as smart as a mouse. Then a rat. Eventually, a rabbit. And perhaps by mid-century, perhaps as smart as a dog or a cat. And by the end of the century, they may be as smart as monkeys. At that point, they could be dangerous. Now, why? What is the tipping point? The tipping point between machines, which are friendly and can do dirty, dull, dangerous jobs, and robots like the Terminator robot, the robot that can wipe out humans. The turning point is the question of self-awareness. Robots do not know they are robots. They are drones. They do what they're told to do. They don't question what the instructions are. They're designed to fulfill a task. No ifs, ands, or buts. They don't complain. They don't bellyache. They don't go on strike. They just do what they're supposed to do because they are drones. However, one day in the future, who knows when, we will have robots that are gradually self-aware. They will realize that, yes, they are robots. They are not humans. And as Stephen Hawking has said, what we have to worry about is when the robots realize that their goals are not the same as our goals. Now realize that today, let's be honest, today robots have no goal at all. They're drones. They just do what they're supposed to do. The whole concept of having a goal, of working out the steps necessary to complete that goal, that's way beyond anything we can do in the laboratory. I once interviewed the former head of the MIT's famous artificial intelligence laboratory, Rodney Brooks. And Rodney Brooks is famous for saying that the chance that an intelligent robot will walk out of somebody's laboratory anytime soon, the probability of that happening is about the same as the probability of a hurricane creating a B-47 jetliner all by itself. In other words, it ain't going to happen anytime soon. However, what do we do now? Well, first of all, we do face a danger now, and that is automatic killing machines. Think of the drones that we use on the battlefield. Eventually, these drones will recognize the human form. And when the command is given, they will kill that human form. However, in the future, one day there could be an accident, there could be a misfire, and then we have an automatic killing machine that kills without permission. That is potentially dangerous. That's a short-term danger. However, it's not an existential threat. And that's why I still say that Mark Zuckerberg is right, at least in the short term, because it means that we don't have self-aware automatic killing machines today. However, does that mean that we shouldn't educate ourselves? Does that mean we shouldn't think about it? No. I think we should start to think about it now, preparing ourselves for the day, decades from now, when robots could pose a mortal threat to us. So, in other words, it ain't going to happen anytime soon. We'll have decades to discuss the question. We're not going to be caught off guard when a sentient robot walks out of someone's basement laboratory and decides to take on the human race. Now you may say to yourself, well, what are we going to do by the end of the century or so when we do have robots with self-awareness? At that point, I think we should put a chip in their brain that will automatically shut them off if they have murderous thoughts. There should be a fail-safe system, a system by which robots can be immobilized, a fail-safe system where we can safely immobilize a robot if they become a danger. But then you say to yourself, well, wait a minute. Let's now talk about 200, 300 years in the future. What happens when robots become so smart they can remove that chip? That no matter how many fail-safe systems we put into them, they're smart enough to evade all of them. What do we do then? Well, at that point, I think we should think about merging with them. Now, you may say to yourself, wow, isn't that kind of extreme, merging with robots? And I say, well, no, because we're already beginning that process. For example, we have been enhancing ourselves for thousands of years. We know from mummies that thousands of years ago, we humans used to paint ourselves, tattoo ourselves, put makeup on, try to make ourselves better looking and smell sweeter. We've been modifying ourselves forever. And look at the modern day era. We have cochlear implants today. We have eyeglasses. We have all sorts of different pacemakers and devices that we put in our hips when our hips wear out. We've been merging with our creations for decades, for centuries, for millennia. And at one point, we may want to merge with them because we may have to leave the Earth. This is not going to happen anytime soon, but yeah, the laws of physics are a death warrant to the planet Earth and life on this planet. In 5 billion years, the sun will eat up the Earth. On a scale of tens of millions of years, another dinosaur-killing type asteroid or meteor will hit the Earth. On a scale of tens of thousands of years, we have to worry about monster volcanic eruptions. We have to worry about new ice ages. Yeah, at some point, we may have to leave the Earth. And at that point, we may have to merge with our creations in order to flourish in outer space. I once interviewed Carl Sagan on exploration, and he said that we have to become a two-planet species. We need an insurance policy because it's simply too dangerous to put humans on one planet. And at that point, we have to modify ourselves. Speaking about reaching for the stars, a new breakthrough was made just a few days ago. There's a program called Breakthrough Starshot. Billionaires are backing it. So far, it's raised $100 million in private funds. Its goal is to send the first starship to the nearby stars. We're talking not about sending the Enterprise or the Millennium Falcon to the nearby stars. No, we're talking about sending a postage stamp-sized chip to the nearby stars, blast it into outer space using a bank of laser beams that will inflate sails placed on these microchips. Now, it turns out that just a few days ago, the Breakthrough Starshot program launched the first chip-sized satellite into orbit. It is the smallest satellite ever to be deliberately sent into orbit. It is 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters big, but that's what we're talking about. We're talking about an object so small that you could send it to 20% the speed of light, energized by the power of 800 gigawatts of power. That's the power generated by 800 nuclear power plants. So at 20% the speed of light, you could reach Alpha Centauri, the nearest star, in just 20 years. Of course, we're not going to be able to land on those planets. We'll simply have a flyby. However, the chip will be full of instruments and sensors, giving us pictures and physical parameters of the planets circling around the Alpha Centauri system. And we already know one. Proxima Centauri b is an Earth-like planet that is circling around the nearest star to the planet Earth. Also making the news, there's a new study by scientists, serious scientists, that have analyzed scores of individuals that claim near-death experiences, and they want to see whether there's any pattern, any rhyme or reason among these reports. And yes, they find that most of these individuals claim one of three things. One is a bright light, a light at the end of the tunnel that they can see. Second, out-of-body experiences where they leave their body. And third, a feeling of calm and restfulness as they approach death. Many of these individuals were involved in car accidents or drowning incidents, but they came back to life just in the nick of time. And that's what they tell us. So scientists have studied these things, first to find out whether there's any pattern or regularity, and second to understand why they have these out-of-death experiences. Well, first of all, they found that almost all of these individuals recorded one of those three things. However, the order, the intensity, the way in which these things were recorded differed for every person that they interviewed. So these individuals did say that, yes, they saw this bright light at the end of the tunnel, but the way in which they saw it, the sequence, changed with individuals. However, the Air Force has also been interested in this because the Air Force puts its pilots in ultracentrifuges, hurling them at tremendous speeds and G-forces just before they black out in a jet airplane. Of course, the Air Force does not want pilots to die if you pull out of a steep dive and lose blood as a consequence. Well, by putting these Air Force pilots in an ultracentrifuge and drawing the blood out of their brain with an ultracentrifuge, what did these pilots see? They saw a tunnel. They saw a bright light at the end of the tunnel. And why is that? Because as blood drains from your brain, blood also drains from your eyes. And the area most affected is the outer rim of your retina. And so blood drains from the outer rim of your retina first, giving you the illusion that there's a tunnel. And what is at the end of the tunnel? A bright light. In fact, the Air Force has a dial by which you could actually dial into and out of this bright light experience. This dial controls the velocity of the ultracentrifuge, and therefore you can balance it just at the point where a pilot begins to lose consciousness. And sure enough, every time a pilot begins the process of losing consciousness, they see a bright light at the end of the tunnel. Other neurologists have analyzed patients that suffer from epilepsy. Epileptics suffer from nerve waves that go ricocheting between left brain and right brain. And in order to save them from having epileptic fits, which are potentially life-threatening, scientists sometimes cut the bond between the left brain and the right brain. Well, in order to do this, you have to, of course, remove parts of the skull. This doesn't hurt at all because the brain has no sensory receptors for pain. So you can literally remove the skull of an epileptic person, and the person can talk to you, and the person feels no pain. Then when you touch different parts of the brain with an electrode, you find something rather startling. When you touch the area that is between two sensory lobes, the person begins to get confused and has an out-of-body experience. Literally, the person thinks that they are leaving the body, hovering over the body. Now, how's that? Because apparently, the brain gets confused between signals from two lobes that govern two different parts of the body. For example, why do you get seasick? You get seasick because what you see and what you feel in your inner ear are different. And as a consequence, the brain gets confused. Your eyes may tell you that you're inside a ship and you are stationary because you're looking at the inside of the ship. However, your inner ear tells you that, no, you are in a boat that's rocking furiously back and forth. And the mismatch between what you see and what you feel causes this out-of-body experience. And it turns out that you could turn it on and off like a light switch. The neurologist who did this experiment on this one woman found that by touching the area, the juncture between two lobes of the living brain, you could induce this out-of-body experience. And then by removing the electrode, it would disappear like a light switch. And so you could turn it on or turn it off. Now, these people who've done these experiments, these neurologists, claim that perhaps that's an explanation for the near-death experience. Because when you are in a near-death experience situation, several things happen. In a near-drowning incident, for example, you lose oxygen to the brain, and that also will induce many of these effects. In fact, scientists found that by regulating the carbon dioxide level that you breathe, to simulate the effect of drowning, for example, you can induce these out-of-body experiences and the bright light. So in other words, scientists say that these individuals, well, maybe they were or maybe they weren't at the gate to heaven. We don't know. But what is measurable in the laboratory, what you can turn on and off like a light switch, is this feeling of out-of-body experience and the bright light at the end of the tunnel. These two things can be induced artificially with a dial. So you can literally dial these experiences, these out-of-body experiences. Also making the front page of the New York Times is a story that we've covered on Exploration. A new cancer therapy is on the horizon. The FDA is expected to approve gene therapy as perhaps the fourth way to attack cancer, in addition to surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation. This involves extracting your own blood and then taking out the T cells, modifying the T cells, reinserting the T cells back into the blood, whereby this modified immune system will then attack cancer. In other words, the body attacks cancer all the time. Believe it or not, your body will in fact destroy cancer cells. However, over a period of time, cancer develops a protein coat that makes them invisible. That's right, the T cells are no longer capable of identifying these modified cancer cells, which naturally grow a protein coat around them. Well, that's where gene therapy comes in. By taking your T cells, modifying them genetically, so they can then recognize these cancer cells that have been mutated, then it's possible to kill them. In fact, in trials so far, patients with incurable leukemia were literally brought back to life. Now, there are side effects, not to mention the fact that the therapy itself could potentially cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, at least initially, until prices begin to drop. Also, some patients reported extreme nausea, extreme discomfort, until finally the fever broke and they were practically cured of cancer. And so we'll keep you abreast of this new therapy, but it shows tremendous promise, so much that it made the front page of the New York Times the other day, a new therapy by which to attack cancer. Of course, there could be other side effects that we have not yet seen. That's why, in some sense, more experiments have to be done. But if it all holds up, it could be perhaps the fourth arrow in our arsenal against cancer. Besides chemotherapy, that is poisoning cancer, besides surgery, that is cutting out the cancer, and besides radiation, that is zapping the cancer, we may have the possibility of strengthening your own natural immune system using gene therapy to the point where it can recognize and then kill cancer cells like our T cells were designed to do by Mother Nature. Well, I'm afraid that's it for the first part of Exploration. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And in the second part of Exploration, we're going to talk about not just artificial life on the Earth, but natural life in the universe. How did life start on the planet Earth? And given the fact that we've located thousands of planets orbiting other stars, then how might life start on other star systems? Well, our special guest in the second half of Exploration is Dr. Robert Hagen, author of the book Genesis. And we'll talk about a new branch of astronomy called astrobiology. That is, the search for life in outer space and how it might have formed using the laws of physics and biology and chemistry. So stay tuned for the second half of Exploration. Welcome. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is the second half of Exploration. In the first half of Exploration, we talked about a number of things, including the possibility of artificial life on the Earth, and will it take over from natural life? Well, in the second half of Exploration, we're going to talk about the evolution of natural life. How did life first form on the planet Earth? And if it formed on the planet Earth, how might it form in outer space? With us today is Dr. Robert Hagen. He's the author of a new book called Genesis, talking about the possibility that life could germinate not just on the planet Earth, but also in outer space as well. And given the fact that the Kepler satellite has detected thousands of planets in outer space, a handful of them which look very similar to the planet Earth, then the question of astrobiology becomes paramount when we look at the heavens. We realize that in the Milky Way galaxy alone, there could be billions of Earth-like planets. And throughout the universe, there could be trillions of Earth-like planets. And to assume that we're the only game in town, I think, is a little bit arrogant. So once again, with us today is Dr. Robert Hagen, author of the book Genesis. And we're going to talk about how life started on the planet Earth and how it might start also in outer space as well. Well, our first special guest today is Dr. Robert Hagen of the Carnegie Institution outside Washington, D.C. He's an astrobiologist, author of the new book, Genesis, and we are talking about how the first spark of life began on the planet Earth about 3.5 billion years ago. The first question for you is, how did you first get interested in science as a youth?
Oh, man, I was so excited about nature when I was young. We had a house in Cleveland, Ohio that backed onto a swamp. And my brother and I would go tramping back, and we'd collect butterflies, and we'd collect frogs, and we'd collect crayfish. And at night, I loved looking up at the sky and the stars. And so my parents bought me a telescope. And the first one was really small, but then I got larger and larger telescopes and ended up building my own. So I loved looking at the sky, and Saturn was my favorite. So nature just turned me on. When I was in high school, I moved to northern New Jersey, and northern New Jersey is just a gold mine for minerals. They're famous mineral localities, and I had a teacher who pointed me in the direction and said, go to Franklin, New Jersey, go to Paterson, New Jersey, collecting minerals, and that's what really got me into mineralogy, which is my main field right through college.
Okay, now you are an expert in an area that is not familiar to the average person, and that is something called astrobiology. So what is astrobiology?
Oh, astrobiology is one of the most amazing new integrated fields in science. It's the study of the origin of life, the distribution of life in the universe, and also discusses what the future of life might be in the universe. This is a field that has been brought to life by major new funding through NASA and the NASA Astrobiology Institute, which is based at the Ames Research Center in California.
Okay, so your book is entitled Genesis, The Scientific Quest for Life's Origin. Let's begin now in the year 1953 with an experiment done by a graduate student under the direction of his advisor by the name of Stanley Miller. Could you tell us a little bit about that experiment and how that led to a paradigm shift with regards to how we view Genesis?
Boy, Professor, what a transformation that was. Stanley Miller, young 23-year-old graduate student at the University of Chicago. His mentor was Harold Urey, who had won the Nobel Prize for the discovery of deuterium, the heavy hydrogen isotope of heavy water. So Urey was incredibly famous. Miller was unknown. Miller came to Urey and said, I want to try an experiment to make the molecules of life from nothing more than a primitive atmosphere. Now, Urey had proposed the primitive atmosphere consisted of hydrogen, methane, which is the natural gas you burn on your stove, and ammonia, that's the strong-smelling chemical from ammonia cleaners. And he mixed those together with water and just ran electric sparks through a piece of glassware. And lo and behold, in just 2 or 3 days, that clear, colorless solution began turning shades of pink and then brown, and then black gunk started getting deposited on the sides of the glassware. Miller had made a whole range of organic molecules that were basic building blocks of life. The amino acids that make our proteins, the sugars that make our carbohydrates, all sorts of molecules that form cell membranes called lipids. And not only that, a few of the bases that are called, these are the molecules that are key components of DNA and RNA. Many of the most fundamental building blocks of life just appeared out of a simple primitive atmosphere and sparks like lightning.
Okay, so let's back up a bit. What we're talking about is getting a flask with horrible chemicals like ammonia, methane, hydrogen, sending a spark through it, essentially replicating what they thought was the early atmosphere of the Earth bombarded by X-rays and lightning bolts and so on and so forth. And bingo, out of that came the building blocks of proteins, amino acids. So what was the reaction of the scientific community, which before that experiment was really basically had no theory as to how organic chemicals could form out of nothing?
It's true. This was a bombshell. The scientific community looked at this and said, wow, this must be how life originated. If in just a couple of days you can go from a simple atmosphere to all these building blocks of life, then given millions of years, the early ocean would just have been chock-a-block full of all kinds of organic molecules, and that was what led to this idea of the primordial soup, an early broth of just the right building blocks for life. So people thought, gee, it's just going to be a matter of 10 or 20 years and we'll know everything there is to know about the origin of life. Of course, that was a little overly optimistic. It's taken us a lot longer and we're still a long way from knowing. But this was the first experiment, the seminal experiment that set us on the path to believing that there is a chemical origin of life going from the simplicity of a geochemical world to the complexity of the biochemical world.
Okay, so back in the 50s, they thought that the early atmosphere of the Earth was a hostile brew of ammonia, methane, hydrogen, and things like that. However, today, we're not so sure.
That's right.
Today, many groups have proposed a different scenario for the formation of life on the Earth, very similar, of course, to what Miller and Urey had, but with a different chemical composition of the soup. What is now the leading theory as to what the atmosphere and the oceans look like back then?
Well, the one thing about the atmosphere is that Urey's idea of an atmosphere with hydrogen and methane is much to what's called reducing. We think that it was a much more chemically neutral atmosphere, including things like nitrogen, the dinitrogen gas that makes up most of our atmosphere today, perhaps some CO2, perhaps other minor components like carbon monoxide, maybe a little bit of methane, maybe some hydrogen, but not as chemically reactive as the atmosphere that Miller proposed. Nevertheless, when you put sparks through any of those atmospheres, you still get very interesting products. So the basic concept of the Miller-Urey experiment is certainly valid. But there are other environments, as you suggest.
Okay. Now, the Alvin submarine, which was used to probe the Titanic riding on the bottom of the ocean, and also to retrieve a hydrogen bomb dropped off the coast of Palomar, Spain, back in the 1950s, was also used to investigate what are called volcano vents. And some people say that perhaps volcano vents is where life got started. It's one theory, but could you elaborate on that theory?
Yeah, the idea here is that life requires a couple of simple ingredients. It requires water, some kind of water-rich environment. It requires energy of some kind. Now, Miller said lightning, other people say sunlight, but you also have the energy from the Earth's inner heat, and you require carbon and other carbon-based compounds, what are called organic molecules. Turns out one of the most exciting environments on Earth where all three of those ingredients come together are the deep ocean vents, the hydrothermal vents, or the black smokers, as they're sometimes called, on the bottom of the ocean. And these were discovered in the late 1970s by scientists diving in the submersible Alvin off the Pacific coast, completely unexpected to find not just these hydrothermal vents, these undersea smokers, if you will, with all sorts of mineral-rich hot fluids coming out, but to find living communities far, far below the influence of the sun, where it's totally dark all the time, and yet life thrives because of all that energy coming out of the ocean floor.
Now, when we talk about energy, we realize that we mammals get our energy by eating plants. So we mammals could not have been the first form of life on the Earth. But plants, in turn, get their energy from sunlight in a very complicated process called photosynthesis, which also could not have been the original energy-generating device because it's very complicated. And we're talking about creating life from nothing, almost. So you're saying essentially that the energy supply could have been this very caustic environment on the bottom of the ocean?
That's the theory, and here's why people think that might be so. In our bodies, the energy, for example, from plants or from sunlight, is converted through a process called oxidation reduction reactions. These are reactions just like that occur in a battery, your flashlight batteries. You're basically transferring electrons from one group of chemicals to another. And that exact same process occurs deep on the ocean floor because very, what are called reducing fluids come out from the below the ocean surface and they hit very oxidizing water in the ocean. And that couple, the oxidation and the reduction together, causes chemical reactions. Just like in a battery, just like in your body, that's what we think the very first energy for life was, just like a battery driven by the Earth.
Okay, now the astronomer Fred Hoyle had a different theory. In fact, he was quite the contrarian within cosmological circles. And he said the following, that the Earth is 4.5 billion years old, roughly speaking. And during the first billion years was the age of asteroids and meteors, constant bombardment by debris from outer space for about a billion years. We see that on the moon even today. And as a consequence, if life formed in the oceans would have boiled off. And therefore, life could not have gotten started within the first billion years. So after the age of meteors ends, boom, bingo, life gets started very soon. So he says this means that life could not have started on the Earth. It came from outer space in the form of spores. So he called this the panspermia theory. But what are your thoughts about the panspermia theory?
Well, at first glance, it sounds like a pretty crackpot idea, you know, life being seeded from outer space. But a lot of scientists are now taking this very seriously. I think there are two possibilities. One is that life is a cosmic imperative. It arises everywhere, and it arises very quickly. I've heard scientists say life comes about in a million years or a thousand years. There's one very famous scientist in the field who even says it takes 2 weeks. Well, if that's true, then life would have arisen on Earth and there's no problem. But what if life does take hundreds of millions of years? We have a planetary neighbor, Mars, that was habitable long before Earth, much less in the way of bombardment by meteorites, much more benign in terms of its temperature early on. And it had oceans or lakes. We now know that from these recent discoveries by NASA. So Mars was habitable hundreds of millions of years before Earth. It's very possible that life arose on Mars, and then there's this amazing mechanism. If Mars gets hit by a modest-sized asteroid, say something that's 10 or 20 or 30 kilometers across, there will be, it's been shown, there'll be rocks thrown up into space, and those rocks will be relatively unheated, relatively unstressed. They could contain microbes. And those microbes could then be brought to Earth by Mars meteorites. So there are a whole group of scientists that are giving very serious consideration to the idea that all life on Earth is Mars life because Mars was habitable earlier. And we may know that if in the next decade or two when we go to Mars, when we look specifically for life, we may find Earth-like life or fossils of Earth-like life on Mars that represent our ancestors.
So if you want to see a Martian, you should simply look in a mirror.
That's possible.
Now, let me ask you a question that's bothered me for a long time, and that is the Earth is roughly 4.5 billion years old, but there's only one DNA molecule, rearranged in different ways, of course, but there's only one DNA. It has ATCG as the building blocks, the nucleic acids. That's why we can eat anything on the Earth. We can eat sea urchins, we can eat insects, we can eat plants, even though we're separated by a tremendous evolutionary distance, because we're all made out of the same molecule. Now, if the Earth is 4.5 billion years old, and life gets started pretty quickly, then how come it didn't start again with another DNA? And again, and again. Why don't we see different DNAs? We only see ATCG. We only see a certain set of amino acids, and that's it. We've had now not just a few hundred million years, but we've had 3.5 billion years of quiet oceans with no meteor impacts to speak of. So why don't we have many DNAs?
Boy, Professor, you know, that's such a great question. And a lot of us are asking the question in this way. Is the chemistry that we see in life today inevitable? Or are there lots of alternative pathways? Well, if there are alternative pathways, why don't we see them? And the explanation that's most often given is that life was a competition. And once that first successful self-replicating cell with all of its proteins and DNA, that very efficient, very powerful mechanism, once that cell got started, then it divided in a flash. You know, microbes can divide in less than an hour. So you had one, then two, then four, then eight. And in a matter of weeks, the whole Earth was populated by that extremely successful self-replicating cell. And that cell ate everything else. You didn't have a chance. If you weren't the first on the block to know how to live and know how to reproduce, then you were going to get eaten because you were food.
Well, let me ask you a question then. Food depends on proteins. Proteins, in turn, depend upon a template, that is DNA template, to create the protein. But there are many proteins that nature has not used. There are many proteins that you can create that nature has not even thought of. So why didn't another DNA get off the ground that was uneatable, inedible, that it was based on proteins that simply cannot be digested by our DNA? And it's not based on ATCG, the four nucleic acids, but it's based on a different set, PQRST or whatever. And it creates proteins that are undigestible by our cells, and therefore the two life forms should coexist. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think partly that life has been very careful in the molecules it selects. For example, RNA uses ribose. DNA uses deoxyribose. Why those particular sugars? These are sugars with five carbon atoms, and there are dozens of different sugars with five carbon atoms. Why those? Well, it turns out there's actually an advantage to those molecules because of their particular shape, and people have shown that if you try to use other molecules, they don't work. So to a certain extent, the molecules that life uses are the best molecules for the job. But also, I think life is incredibly good at taking various other potential molecules and eating them. It's just amazing how life has used all different kinds. Anything in its environment that has energy, life has learned to eat. And I think it's just once you get one kind of life established, it's really hard to get a second competitive system going. It's sort of like the ultimate monopoly. You can imagine some company makes the best car, the best computer, and other companies try to get started. But if that first company is so huge and so large, it just swallows up the competition and nothing else to get going. Sort of like the diamond monopoly of De Beers. You know, there's never been another big company making diamonds because De Beers buys them all up and swallows up the competition.
Well, the reason I ask you this is because in science fiction movies, we always see aliens from outer space that want some very specific things. First of all, they want to eat us, meaning that they can digest our proteins, which I find remarkable. Second of all, they're going to want to mate with us, in which case they have basically the same DNA as us, literally, so they can interchange DNA sequences with us. And I find this rather impossible. But what you're saying is that in some sense, DNA really is preferable. And that maybe when aliens from outer space land on the Earth, they're going to have DNA which is very similar to ours. Is that what you're saying?
I think it's possible that some aspects of biochemistry will be very, very similar, maybe even DNA and RNA. But I think there will be very important differences. For one thing, we have what's called the genetic code. And that basically are sets of three genetic letters that match up to different amino acids, the building blocks of protein. I think that code may be wildly different there is a code on other worlds, that it would be very different from ours. So I can't imagine there being that kind of unity. So there's some chance events, some chance chemical events in the origin of life. But I think there are also some aspects of origins that are going to be very similar from world to world.
Okay, well, if you say that, if another DNA got off the ground and our DNA basically ate up that DNA, then what happens when alien DNA reaches the Earth? Will our DNA consume, molecule for molecule, their DNA, or vice versa? Perhaps their DNA will consume ours.
Well, that's a real good question. It depends on the building block molecules. I can imagine alien DNA. I can imagine alien proteins that are totally poisonous to us, and vice versa. It's also very possible that life on other worlds started with an opposite-handedness. There is a very curious characteristic of life on Earth that all of the sugar molecules used in DNA and RNA are called right-handed. All the amino acids used in proteins are what are called left-handed. So there are mirror image molecules that our bodies can't use. In fact, that's one for dieting. There's a new product out. You can buy left-handed sugars, which taste sweet, but the body can't digest them. So this is one kind of artificial sweetener, which gives you no calories. It's a great invention. It's a great idea. So if there were an alien life form that happened to be reversed, and they used left-handed sugars and right-handed amino acids, then they couldn't eat us, we couldn't eat them. I think we'd probably get along.
Okay. Now let's get back to the Miller experiment, because there's a huge gap that we left unfilled. Miller showed that amino acids, in some sense, are for free. We see them in nebulas in outer space. We see them in the cores of meteors from outer space. Amino acids are out there in outer space. However, DNA is extremely complicated. If you look at a DNA molecule, you say to yourself, oh my God, look at that thing. And it would have taken an awful long time for Miller to get a DNA molecule off the ground. If he had done his experiment for maybe a billion years in that little test tube, then maybe he would have gotten one DNA molecule off the ground. So there's missing steps now. So some people say that before DNA, there was RNA. And before RNA, there was even more primitive structures even before RNA. So what do we know about the gap between the amino acids that are for free that we see in the Miller experiment and RNA and DNA?
This is probably the single biggest uncertainty in question, but there's so many great ideas out there. For one thing, as you say, RNA is a very complicated molecule. It's hard to imagine how it was synthesized from scratch in a prebiotic soup. Mineral surfaces may have helped. There are some minerals that attract ribose. There are some minerals that attract the bases. But there are other neat ideas out there. In the book, Genesis, I describe an experiment by a person at our laboratory, a guy named Nick Platts, who realized that you could build up an RNA-like molecule from very, very simple building blocks, little cyclical molecules, the kinds of things that are produced when diesel exhaust burns or when you have a sooty fire. That soot itself, if you put it in water under just the right circumstances, will form tiny little stacks of molecules. And those stacks, if they're in just the right environment, will attract the bases, the four letters A, T, C, and G of DNA. And those bases can line up on top of each other, and you can actually make a RNA-like molecule from scratch on the primitive Earth. Now, it's very possible, I think, that this is the sort of intermediate step where you build something that's simple from simple building blocks, and that mimics what's going to become more and more complex. You add layers of complexity gradual, one step at a time. So Nick Platt's idea is very, very powerful, and it's now being studied experimentally. That's the kind of thing people look for. You go from simplicity to complexity through a process known as emergence.
Now, if you go back, way back into the past, and what do we know about the most primitive DNA or RNA on the Earth?
Oh, Professor, that's a wonderful question, because it has to do with what are essentially the most primitive biochemical features. What are the chemical fossils that we find in modern life that point to the earliest life? And I think the conclusion is unambiguous. There are a few chemical pathways that are buried in every single living thing. One of those is RNA, the ability for RNA not only to store information and pass it on from one generation to the next, but also for RNA to improve or catalyze certain reactions. Another is a cycle of what is known as metabolism, that is taking energy and atoms from the surrounding and building up new molecules. There's something called the citric acid cycle that seems to be built into every living thing. And there are a few other chemical pathways, the ability to take nitrogen and convert it to ammonia, for example. That's also fundamental. That's a way of using the element nitrogen in biological systems. So there are a few chemical pathways that we find in every living thing, and those we believe are the most primitive chemical pathways that point us to something about the earliest life.
And where are these organisms that are the most ancient, most primitive forms of life on the Earth? Are they in the bottom of the ocean?
Right now, the most primitive organisms that we know of are all in very extreme environments, in places where the acidity is very high, in places where it's very cold, in hot, deep hydrothermal vents. And people have two ideas about that. One is the possible, very real possibility that life originated in one of these extreme environments. The other possibility is that life originated near the surface, like Stanley Miller would say, but because of those nasty asteroids and meteors and comets that kept blasting the surface, the only life that survived those last insults was life that had adapted to the deep, hot, protected environments within the Earth's crust. So either way, those are the most primitive organisms that we see today.
So, of course, the last observation that we can make is, will we ever know? Will we ever know how life got started on the Earth and how life may start in outer space? And the answer may come sooner than you realize because, of course, we have probes on Mars looking for evidence of life, looking for evidence of microbial life. And we've also identified several candidates that are very similar to the planet Earth. Perhaps twins of the planet Earth. Perhaps these twin Earths have atmospheres. Perhaps they have liquid oceans. And perhaps we should even look for radio signals emitted from these distant planets. And perhaps, just perhaps, they have intelligent life on them, capable of broadcasting radio and being detected by Earthlings looking for life in outer space. Who knows for sure, but the answer may come very soon in the next few decades. Well, I'm afraid that's it for Exploration. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, professor of theoretical physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. You've been listening to an interview with Dr. Robert Hagen, astrobiologist and author of the book Genesis. And if you want a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230. Once again, for a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230. Good day.